So this used to be all black with a black shaft, and I popped the orange end cap on and I gave that to Linus to be like, hey, this is prototype number one. Unfortunately, Linus cannot contain his excitement sometimes, so he posted on Twitter like 20 minutes later. And that's how the orange screwdriver was born. I'm Kyle, I'm the engineering manager at Creator Warehouse, division of LTT. And yeah, I make stuff. I was the project lead on the screwdriver. There was a lot of talented people that came together to make this, but it was the first project I worked on at LMG. I'd pretty much tell you the story of how the early stages of the projects came to be. So basically my day one to 2 years after I got hired. When I came here, we had a Mark III and a SL1 that had just arrived. So Alex Clark was the one who came up with the design of the handle. This is Alex's design philosophy. Make a ton of different versions and get Linus to try all of them. This was made on a Mark III and he numbered them, and he took the SOLIDWORKS model and changed various parameters because he knew roughly what he wanted. He just didn't know exactly what features he did want. He went through a bunch of iterations and each gave them to Linus to hold and play with, and Linus would give feedback, he would iterate and he would print it again. Until we finally got to the final design that our handle ended up being, which is this nice trilobular line with these three flats. It's designed to sit naturally in a claw grip. That way you can, when you refeed on it, it sits nicely in your knuckles and you can get a decent amount of turning force on it. That's all very well and good, but we didn't really have a design for the selector and the end cap. When I arrived in 2020, we had the final design of the outside of the handle and four different options for the end cap and the selector. Now, Linus had already chosen the selector that he liked. So my first goal was to come up with what end cap we needed to go with. He disliked some features of the four options that we had. So what I did was I 3D printed the first full screwdriver and sanded it down just to like remove some of the layer lines to try and get as close to finished feel as I could with the resources that I had. And while I printed, I used the slicer's pause layer feature to embed magnets inside the handle, as well as I think 17 different end caps. And then what I did was I got Linus to hold the screwdriver. He's like, oh, this feels good. And then I put the end cap on. He's like, no, I don't like this. Then we swapped it out. We eventually landed on something very close to the final design. It was a lot squarer and the protrusions were a little bit more aggressive than they are now. So a little bit of SOLIDWORKS later, trying different roundover angles and different geometries for the protrusions, we came with our final design. And once Linus said go, it was time to write the check to the tooling company. And it was multiple six figures. I don't know if Linus has said the exact number on screen, but it was expensive. And I had to make the call whether it was ready or not. I'm cutting out a whole bunch of work that we had to do to make the insides work. There are inside features to the screwdriver that's required to make it like actually shift its gears and stuff. But it's like a deer in the headlight moment is a saying that I use often. It's like, are we ready to cut the check? Before I said yes to that, I used the SL1 to make as close to accurate as possible. I mean, it still was a different material. We use a ABS nylon polymer, and this is resin, orange resin. This is the exact final model of the end cap, the exact final model of the selector, and the exact final model of the handle with all their internal features. I used that and gave it to Linus and kind of checked all the dimensions over, tried to make it as functioning prototype as I could with the stuff that we had. Yeah, that was the final thing we did before pressing go on the molds. That was at the tail end of 2020 and the beginning of 2021. Yeah, that's how we used a Mark III and an SL1 to kind of make the first non-functional prototypes of the screwdriver. And a funny story is, if you see the first tweet Linus made about the screwdriver, it was a little bit beyond the time frame that I'm talking about. There was a significant gap where we actually had to make the ratchet internals work before we got a final working prototype. When we got that working prototype, I didn't have the correct end cap from the injection mold company yet. They were still actually making that and I hadn't tested the mold yet, but I did have a 3D printed one. So what I did was I had everything else. This used to be all black with a black shaft, and I popped the orange end cap on and I gave that to Linus to be like, hey, this is prototype number one. Unfortunately, Linus cannot contain his excitement sometimes, so he posted on Twitter like 20 minutes later. And that's how the orange screwdriver was born, because as soon as that came, everyone was like, oh, we need an orange screwdriver. And I was like, no, we weren't planning for an orange screwdriver, it's all black. And he's like, but I posted this on Twitter and everyone wants an orange. And I'm like, well, why did you do that? But that just shows how accurate the prints were, that the end cap actually fits the injection molded parts. So, some cool history. Over my years working with Linus, I've learned to adjust my design style to match his creativity. Linus is what I like to describe as a discovery type creator. He creates by talking about his experiences and what could be done better. So the best way to design something for him is to put something physical in his hand. You will see this in the way Alex progressed through his handles. He just started with something that was vaguely what Linus wanted. Linus wanted something similar to the screwdriver he was using at the time. He started with something and Linus will hold it and be like, I don't like this, this, and this. So then you'd make the change, and then, you know, number four, then number five, then number six, then number seven, right? So it's a logical progression as Linus kind of discovers what he likes and what he doesn't like. The reason why 3D printing is so pivotal on that is it just cuts down the time between talking to Linus. Like, it cuts down the development cycle. It takes us a couple hours to print these, right? So in a matter of like a week, you can have them go through seven different samples if you can get them alone for that amount of time. Alternatively, what I use it for is if there's a bunch of different things he needs to decide between, instead of having him try one and then iterate and try another, I just did like a shotgun blast of 17 different end caps, ranked it in order of the ones he hated, and then started trying to combine feature sets of the ones he liked. It just gave us more ability to work with Linus, who's is a person who needs something physical to enable to get the concepts in his mind out in words that we can actually turn into a spec sheet or something like that actually has meaning rather than something nebulous. I want the best screwdriver. Make it. For engineering, it doesn't work very well. Showing him like a SolidWorks model in CAD usually doesn't work very well. Showing him a render might get you better results. The design side will show him more renders and pictures because that way he can articulate it better, especially if you have a physical t-shirt. You can just be like, well, that's what the picture's gonna look like. When you need to test usability, like hand feel, weight. If you pick up a screwdriver and it's light, 9 times out of 10, people are gonna think it's cheap. Right. For some reason, when you pick up a screwdriver, you need to feel some heft to it, right? And when you're trying to deal with someone like Linus, who has this perception of quality, he needs to be able to pick it up and feel confident, like, hey, if this is what the final product's going to be, I'm happy. You know, without 3D printing tools, you're stuck with trying to do prototype level manufacturing, which adds a whole bunch of cost and complexity and time to the situation. If you're trying to do it cheap and fast, 3D printing can get you most of the way there. Every time you make a product, there is a cost and a business case to be made for it. When I'm pitching new product ideas to upper management and Linus and that, I do have to keep in mind engineering time, prototyping cost spend, because while you might not see that on the COGS sheet, like revenue minus cost of goods sold and stuff like that, it does get wrapped up into kind of like your overhead cost, right? You do have to account for the money that you're spending on prototype. If you're obfuscating or hiding that cost, then you're kind of doing yourself a disservice, right? If we made the screwdriver and it was successful, but then we spent millions and millions and millions of dollars prototyping, well, you don't get to see that profit. So yes, you have to keep in mind prototyping costs, because keeping those down while still effectively prototyping. You don't want to cheap out to a point where you're not getting an accurate prototype, but at the same time, you don't want to spend thousands where you can just spend hundreds. It's kind of our mentality. We also have a team saying fail fast, right? So speed is also money. Like, time is also money. If we have to spend weeks or months at a time in one prototyping iteration, that has a monetary value to it. Especially if you get to a point, Linus picks it up and it's completely not what he wanted. So being able to 3D print, fail fast, iterate, fail cheap is something that's very advantageous in, you know, even a professional design situation.